And we'll ask again, bless each one of us who joined here to enrich our knowledge through our wisdom from the Bible. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you.
Good evening, friends. Thank you so much, Mr. Johnson, for beginning with the word of prayer. And thank you, all the participants, for this evening's Bible study. I'm sure that we will have a blessed time together, looking at the Bible, learning from the Bible, and also learning to live according to the Bible. Shall we begin by praising and honoring God? Shall we have a time of singing so that we can join together and we can offer our praises to God?
So we're going to sing Great is Thy Faithfulness. We can be on mute and we can worship the Lord together.
Provided.
Thanks, Jude. So we'll begin with the reading for this evening. So it is from the second chapter of Acts of the Apostles, verses beginning from 14 onwards. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know this man, handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence." So friends, last session, we had a discussion about the first 13 verses in the second chapter of the Acts of the Apostles, the day of the Pentecost, where a lot of believers had gathered together, and how they experienced certain very extraordinary sights and sounds, and how the Holy Spirit was imparted to them. And after receiving the Holy Spirit, the great transformation that they experienced, speaking in the languages of others. So it was a very strong display of God's power, and also the fulfillment of God's promises. So now we begin with verse 14. Verse 14, it starts by saying, "But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them." Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice. So standing, Peter standing and raising his voice. This was a very important way of describing an orator, especially in the Greek culture, in the times of antiquity, very early times. It was always important for the orator to stand and raise his voice and speak. So that was more symbolic. So Peter here continues with the tradition, and here as an orator, he begins his speech or his sermon. So Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. So he addresses not only the community of believers who received the Holy Spirit, but also the other visitors to Jerusalem, and also the residents of Jerusalem, some of whom were appreciating whatever was happening, some of whom were spellbound, and some of whom were also mocking the believers by saying that they are drunk, they are filled with new wine. So in that context, Peter begins his sermon. So this sermon is a very powerful sermon, and this sermon would actually capture the essence of early Christian preaching. We might wonder, what was the early Christian message all about? How did preaching begin? What was the content of the early Christian proclamation? So the Sermon of Peter here is a model for us to understand how early Christian preaching was executed and what were its contents. So when you look at this particular passage, we can divide it into two portions. From verse 14 to 21, there is an explanation of what happened on the day of Pentecost. So it was all the doing of the Spirit, and it was not anything to do with new wine, not about people being drunk, but people being filled with the Holy Spirit. So there is an explanation to that, and the explanation is derived from the Old Testament prophecies. So it is mentioned that the Old Testament prophecies were fulfilled. And then when you look at verses 22 to 36, there you find the proclamation of the message of Jesus Christ. The life, ministry, destiny of Jesus, and how the people of Palestine responded to Jesus' message. So there is a brief description of the life and witness of Jesus in that particular passage from verses 22 to 36. So Peter, standing with the 11, raising his voice and addressing them, he says, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem." Men of Judea. When you look at how Peter addresses the people who are gathered there, you can see a very important and interesting transition in the way Peter addresses the crowd. So when you look at verse 14, it says, "Men of Judea," or the more appropriate translation would be "men Jews." Men who are Jews. And when later you move towards verse 22, it is "men Israelites." Men Israelites. That is verse 22. And then when you go to verse 29, it is "men brothers." I'm talking about the actual literal translation. So in verse 14, it is "men Jews." In verse 22, it is "men Israelites." And in 20, and finally in verse 37, it is "brothers." So we see a kind of very interesting strategy adopted by Peter as he addresses the crowd. So initially, he kind of addresses them with their particular location, their particular identity of being Judeans. And then later, he kind of has a more broader outlook by calling them Israelites. And then later calling them brothers. So forging a relationship with them, a very intimate personal relationship with them. And finally, it is brothers again, which talks about the kind of intimacy that Peter would require from the respondents or the audience to his message. So Peter addressing the crowd in a very intimate, poignant manner so that he can strike a chord with them and he can also have a relationship with them. And that is very important when you look at the oratory skills of Peter, how he was able to really develop a personal relationship with the people there. So Peter begins by saying, "Indeed, these are not drunk." So it begins with a pronouncement of innocence. The people who are gathered there assume and mock the people who are filled with the Holy Spirit by calling them drunk and saying that they are filled with new wine. So when Peter begins with a statement of proving that these people are innocent. So he says, "Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning." It is too early in the morning for anybody to be drunk. And these people, the believers of Christ, are not drunk. So that is what Peter mentions very clearly here. "Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning." A very interesting aspect in this particular sermon of Peter is that in the first portion, which I told begins from verse 14 and ends in 21, he talks about how the believers are not really condemned by the people who are mocking them. They're not guilty of whatever the mockers are saying. So Peter begins by talking about their innocence. But when you move from verse 22 onwards, Peter will be speaking more about the guilt of the people who lived in Palestine during Jesus' time and how they were contributive towards killing Jesus. So to begin with, an indictment in favor of the people there by saying that they are not guilty. And then later from verse 22 onwards, it is more about the guilt of the people who did not respond to the message of Jesus. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. So whatever you are seeing and hearing is nothing strange. There is a continuation. It is not something which just occurred. It is not a coincidence. It is not an accident, but rather it is a continuation of the Old Testament prophecies. And it is not only a continuation, but it is the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy. And Peter would quote from Joel, the Old Testament prophet. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. The last days, a very important term. So Joel talks about the last days, the end times, or in theological terms, we call it as eschatological. Eschatology means the study of the end times. So here, Joel is saying that in the last days of God actually bringing about an end to the present era and also starting a new era, maybe the era of the kingdom of God. And that is what is mentioned here. In the last days, it will be, God declares. Even when you look at the book of Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2, there also we find a reference to how God spoke through Jesus Christ in the last days. So Jesus initiates the last days. The last days means it is an end to the kingdom of this world and it initiates the kingdom of God. And that is what the last days, according to the prophets, were about. Because the prophets are speaking to people who are very much disturbed about what is happening around them. There is grave injustice. There is so much of suffering. There is so much dishonesty, wickedness, evil. And in that particular situation, the main question that people ask is, what do we understand by what is happening around us? How do we comprehend what is happening around us? Where is God? And what is God doing? So in that particular situation, the prophets offer them hope by telling that there will be a time. There will be a time when God will put an end to all the wickedness, the evil, and all the dishonesty that you find in this world. And God will initiate his rule, his reign, and his kingdom, which is so important. And the last days are about the hope that this particular kingdom of the world will be destroyed. And there will be a new kingdom of God where new values, values affirming life, values affirming dignity, justice, peace, and joy will be affirmed. And this is what Peter is mentioning by referring to the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. So there is a promise that the Holy Spirit will be poured out and God himself will pour out this Holy Spirit. There will not be a third agency, there will not be another agency, but rather God taking the initiative to give the gift of the Holy Spirit to everybody who responds to him. And that is the reason Peter says, quoting Joel, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, no distinction at all, no high, low, no discrimination, no inequality, but rather God's Holy Spirit is accessible and available for everybody. We might come across certain traditions or even certain religious literature where the wisdom of God or even the gifts of God are actually limited, or it is kind of designed only for a particular community, and the other communities cannot even dare to listen to those words or even write those words or something like that. But in this context, it is very important for us to understand that our God is an impartial God, a God who pours out his Holy Spirit on all flesh, irrespective of whatever backgrounds they belong to. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. the prophetic ministry. Everybody will be involved in the prophetic ministry. What is the prophetic ministry? Many times we think prophetic ministry is about foretelling. It's about telling something which may happen in the future. It is about prediction. But prophetic ministry is not about prediction alone. It is not about foretelling. It is more about forthtelling. So prophetic ministry is about telling the truth in whatever situation that we find in. Whether it was the prophets who lived during the time of Saul, David, who had the courage to stand up to those kings and tell them that whatever they did is wrong. Or even the prophet who stood up against King Ahab and told him that what you are doing is wrong. So prophetic ministry is about completely committing yourselves to do the will of God, and for that purpose, daring to oppose the powers and principalities of this world. Sometimes we have this temptation where we think, why not? Why not compromise? Why not listen to both? There can be a kind of understanding between the voice of God and the voice of the world, and we will try to bring about that synchronization. But Jesus says, you cannot have two masters. You will love one and you will hate the other. You have to make a choice. You have to choose one. And that is what prophetic ministry is about. All the prophets chose to speak the word of God. Although speaking the word of God was very dangerous, they had to endure a lot of hardships. They had to go through a lot of sufferings, persecutions. But even then, they dared to speak the truth to the powers. And that is what prophetic ministry is. So the end days will be a time when people will speak the word of God. So when your sons and daughters shall prophesy, it means that everybody, irrespective of whatever distinctions or discriminations, will speak the word of God. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall see dreams, shall dream dreams. Visions and dreams are so very important. They are like vehicles of divine manifestation. When you look at the entire Bible, dreams have such a very important role, whether it was the dreams of Joseph, the dreams of Daniel, and even in the New Testament, when you have so many dreams, especially when Jesus is being born, the dreams of Joseph, his father, and God speaking God's word through a lot of dreams, communicating. So dreams, and again visions, you have innumerable visions in the Bible. So God communicating God's truth through dreams and visions. So young men shall see visions and your old men shall dream dreams. So the Holy Spirit is poured out upon everyone and everyone is equipped. The sons are equipped, the daughters are equipped. So that there is no distinction in terms of gender. The young and the old will see. There is no ageism. There is no discrimination based on age here. And even upon my slaves. So there is no master-slave distinction as well. And that is the reason Paul would very famously say in Galatians 3:27, if all of us are in Christ, there is neither male nor female. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither master nor slave. All of us are one in Christ. And that is the kind of relationship that the prophet Joel foresaw. And Peter repeats those words of Joel. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days, I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy. They shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. We are in anticipation of that great and glorious day when God will come to judge. The second coming of Jesus, because we believe in that. Even in our creeds, we say that we are waiting for him to come back because he will judge the world with righteousness. And these are certain signs. But sometimes we become so very obsessed with these signs that anyway we hear about anything even remotely similar to whatever is mentioned here, we immediately get into that speculation mode. We try to speculate whether this is the end times, whether this is the time God is speaking about in the Bible. But the Bible makes it very clear. And even when we were reading the first chapter of Acts of the Apostles, it was made very clear to us that we are called to be witnesses. We are not called to be speculators. not going to be speculators, because nobody knows when this will happen. And even when people ask for a sign in Jesus' time, Jesus refused to give a sign. So we need to understand that there will be certain signs which may not be discerned by everybody. But what is more important is that we continue to witness, irrespective of whether the coming of the Lord is tonight or tomorrow or even 10 years later. So not being laid back, not being complacent, but always being witnesses rather than being speculators. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So there is another opportunity for people to be saved, to receive the salvation of God. So everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But when I read this verse, I'm also reminded of another verse from Matthew's Gospel. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, which gives us a little different view, maybe an expansion of what we see here in Acts. So Matthew 7, 21, which goes on like this. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of God, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. So Acts says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But Jesus also cautions us, saying that if it is a superficial, a very shallow calling on the name of God, the Lord, that is not sufficient. So to call on the name of the Lord means experiencing a transformation in our lives, which is deep, which is profound, which is honest, and which is real. Something which cannot be faked. Something which cannot be represented in a very hypocritical manner, but rather a real change that we experience. And when we experience that change and call to God, God provides us with the salvation. So everybody who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So Acts talks about the real calling, not merely addressing God as Lord, Lord all the times. Because Jesus says, everybody who calls me Lord, Lord will not be saved. They will not even enter the kingdom of God. It is more important to do the will of the Lord. It is very important for us to read this verse in comparison with Matthew 7:21 as well. You can read that later. And then we go on to verse 21, where Peter actually begins his sermon. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. So there is a description of who this Jesus is. Jesus of Nazareth. The humble origin of Jesus is affirmed here. Jesus from Nazareth, a very small place in the region of Galilee. Maybe in our language, we may also call it as a God-forsaken place. But what we actually term as God-forsaken is actually the place which God has embraced. And Jesus grew up in Nazareth. Even when the first disciples of Jesus encounter the message that Jesus or the Messiah has come, and Philip says to Nathanael, we have seen the Messiah. Nathanael says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Nazareth, such a God-forsaken place. Nazareth, a place filled with peasants, a place filled with very crude people. And how can the Messiah come from there? But Peter makes it very, very, very strong here and says, Jesus of Nazareth. Let us not forget where the gospel began. Because sometimes even in our modern spirituality, there is this obsession with Europe. And we think that the gospel came from Europe. The gospel did not come from Europe. The gospel originated in Asia. The gospel originated in Nazareth. The gospel began in Galilee, in Palestine. And from there, it traveled across the world. So for us to remember that this gospel, which talks about the salvation of the entire humankind, which talks about the redemption of God's entire creation, will actually begin from a very small place. A very small place called Nazareth. Jesus born in Bethlehem, but raised in Nazareth. So Jesus of Nazareth, a man. Again, the humanity of Jesus very strongly affirmed here. That is the reason in the creeds we say fully human and fully divine. So Jesus was not 80% divine and 20% human. Or Jesus was not only a divine being who just appeared on the earth, but Jesus lived as a real human being. He took on the form of a human being. And this humanity of Jesus is very important, something that should not be negated. He went through the extreme feelings and emotions of human beings. He cried, he laughed, he was hungry, he was thirsty, he was deceived, he was appreciated. He went through a lot of emotions, whatever emotions the human beings can go through. Even that final moment of the cross when he felt that he was being abandoned by God. So he completely lived as a human being. And that is what Peter begins. So when Peter begins speaking about Jesus, it is very important that Peter gives full attention to the historical realities, to the ground realities by saying Jesus from Nazareth and Jesus a man attested to you by God. So God certified to this man. And how does God certify? With deeds of power, wonders and signs that God did through him among you. So this Jesus is not only a human being, this Jesus is also divine. He is part of the Trinity. He is the God in whom we belong, in whom we believe. So that is the reason this Jesus performed great signs, miracles, great manifestations of power and glory. So this Jesus is fully human and fully divine. As you yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. So Jesus' coming into this world was not an accident. Jesus' coming into this world was ordained by God. So God sent his only son. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He sent his only begotten son into this world so that there will be a reconciliation possible between humankind and God and between human beings themselves. So that is the main purpose for which Jesus came, to bring about an unity, to bring about peace, to bring about reconciliation, and to offer God salvation, so that through salvation we can draw near to God. And here again, it says very importantly that this Jesus was handed over to the people of this nation, to the people of this land, according to the definite plan. God is very clear, God is very definite about what he is doing through Jesus. And the Old Testament is witness to that. So there is the expectation, there is a hope. And in the New Testament, we see that this hope and the anticipation is fulfilled. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. So here there is a very strong statement of blame. So Peter is condemning the people to whom he is speaking. He's telling them, you crucified. You crucified and killed this Lord. Very important. So Jesus did not embrace death. Jesus was killed. And this verse makes it very clear. The murder of Jesus. I mean, certainly when we go to other portions, we will read that more in detail. But how Jesus was crucified and killed by the people whom he served. And that is what Peter is saying here. And Peter is so bold and courageous to do that. Jerusalem. The scene is happening in Jerusalem. It's a very public scene. And Peter has the courage to look at a group of people, a large group of people, and say, you killed my Lord. You crucified Jesus of Nazareth. That would require a lot of courage. We know that Jerusalem is a city that kills prophets. Jesus has already lamented about Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city which kills prophets. And it also killed the Son of God. And there is so much of security to the tomb of Jesus that they expected that the body of Jesus will be stolen and maybe his disciples will steal that. And they were on the lookout for the disciples. But the disciples, emboldened by the Holy Spirit, encouraged by Jesus, speak these powerful, courageous words very publicly and tell the people, you killed him. He did not die by himself. You killed him. And that's a very strong statement to be done. And we will certainly come back to this in the following speeches as well. But I'll just leave that thought with you so that you can think a little more about that. About the role of the people in terms of killing the Son of God, the murder of the Son of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. So it was not only the people of that land who actually conspired to kill Jesus, but they also joined forces with the people outside the law, outside the Jewish law, the Romans. The role of the Roman administration, the role of the Roman governance in terms of killing Jesus. So Peter is making a very powerful statement. He's saying, you people of Palestine, you are the ones involved in crucifying Jesus, and you colluded with the Romans, those outside the law, to kill the Son of God, to kill the Messiah. But one danger that we see in this particular interpretation is sometimes there is a kind of scapegoating of the Jews. The Jews as the killers of Jesus. We have seen a long history. We've seen how Adolf Hitler utilized this to justify his program of killing numerous Jews in Germany. He was actually appealing to the Christian sentiments, where the Christians were provoked and provoked by him by saying that this Jesus was actually killed by the Jews. So the Jews are enemies of Christians, the enemies of Christ. And we have the infamous Holocaust and the great tribulations, the genocides that followed. So when we read this particular passage, we should not come to a conclusion that Peter is actually condemning or blaming the Jews for the murder of Jesus. It is not a kind of debate between a Christian and Jews, but Peter himself is a Jew here. It is more of an insider conversation, a group of Jews, and Peter himself being a Jew, and talking about a particular group of people at a particular time being responsible for the murder of Jesus. So it is very important that we do not give any kind of leeway for anti-Semitic thoughts, anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism is such a very strong ideology which has led to the hounding of the Jews and killing of numerous people. So this particular verse should not be used for that. So it is an insider conversation. Peter as a Jew conversing with other Jews, not a kind of Christian versus Jew debate. So this is important for our understanding. But God raised him up having freedom from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. So death is not the final say in terms of Jesus' life. And that is the reason God raised him up having freedom from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. The Son of God cannot be held in the power of death. And Peter makes a very profound, a very powerful statement about that. And he also quotes from Psalm 16. He quotes from Psalm 16. You see the next few verses from 25 to 28. These are verses from Psalm 16. Peter is not actually justifying resurrection or explaining resurrection. Peter is actually pronouncing or proclaiming resurrection, because the audience is familiar with the idea of resurrection. Peter does not have to justify it. Peter does not have to prove it with evidence, with the witness. But rather, Peter starts with a given that people in that particular scenario believed in resurrection. And Peter says that Jesus was resurrected. And for this, he uses a Psalm of David, Psalm 16, where there is a kind of allusion to resurrection there. I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. So David talking about how the soul will not be abandoned to Hades. but how there will be a resurrection. And Peter using that particular line of thought from David to actually explain about what is happening to Jesus here. So friends, I would like to close with this. We are in the middle of the sermon. We will continue with this remaining part of the sermon in the next session. So until verse 28, we've just come to the first half of Peter's sermon. And then we will continue with Peter's sermon and also see what is the response to Peter's sermon. How do the people respond to his sermon in the next session? If you have any comments to be made, any insights that you received while you were reading the text, you're free to express them now. We just spent a few minutes, 5 minutes or so for that, and then we'll conclude.